statement of Councillor Coleman, Councillor Spurrell is deputising, and Councillor Rennie, who's not so well at the moment.
Are there any further apologies? Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. Do you have any declarations of interest in relation to any item? No?
No.
Okay. Are there any matters of urgency to address on the agenda? No? Okay, in that case, we're on agenda item 6, which is exempt. So I'm going to have to ask any members of the press or public to leave at this point.
Should we do that at the end, Chair?
Do you think perhaps we should take that at the end?
Yeah.
I think that probably makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay. In that case, then, if we go to item 2, which is the minutes of the previous meeting.
A different set of councillors at that time, but that's agreed, Chair.
Is that agreed then?
Yeah.
Okay, in that case, we move on to agenda item 3. Yes?
Yeah. Thanks, Chair. The authority is required to prepare an annual statement reviewing the authority's governance and systems of internal control arrangements that were in operation during the year. The annual governance statement meets that requirement. The Audit Committee on the 6th of June approved the 2018-19 annual governance statement attached as Appendix A to the report. However, the authority's auditor, Grant Thornton, have requested the inclusion of a couple of additional paragraphs to confirm the view of those signing off the statement that the governance and internal control arrangements were fit for purpose and provided acceptable overall assurance, and the arrangements have been operating throughout 2018-19 and have provided an effective framework for identifying and dealing with any governance issues in the year. The annual governance statement attached as Appendix B to the report is the revised annual governance statement that now includes the required statements outlined in paragraph 4, pages 9 and 10, and requested by Grant Thornton. And members are asked to approve the revised annual governance statement and that the Chair sign the statement on behalf of the authority. I'm happy to take any questions.
No, but the beauty of this decision is that you have to sign it, not me.
The Chair did sign the original one of the Audit Committee as well.
Yeah, I've already seen this. So. We asked questions about the Audit Committee, so I won't repeat the questions here. Anything else?
Just technical additions, isn't it? Yes, so.
Okay. Item 4. Is there any capital outset?
Thanks, Chair. This report provides members with a summary of the outstanding position in relation to the approved 2018-19 revenue and capital budgets. Pages 36 to 38 provide members with some background information on the 2018-19 budget plan and the budget updates approved throughout the year. And as per paragraph 13 on page 39, the revenue outturn position was at £826,000 net underspend. However, members approved a strategy at the 2019-20 Budget Authority of utilising any savings to fund an increase in debt payments, the minimum revenue provision, in order to free up future years' budgets to increase spend on frontline services. Therefore, after increasing the MRP by the £826,000, the overall revenue outturn position is consistent with the approved budget. Paragraph 14 on page 39 to 40 provides members with an explanation of the major revenue variances for 2018-19, and Appendix A provides a detailed analysis of the revenue outturn position. Paragraph 16 to 18 on pages 40 to 42 summarises the opening and closing position on committed earmarked reserves. Total committed earmarked reserves reduced by £2.651 million, or 10% in the year, and the general revenue reserve remained unchanged at £2 million. Paragraph 19 to 21 on pages 42 to 44 outlines the capital outturn position. A £3.83 million of planned 2018-19 spend has now been rephased into 2019-20. And the table on page 43 provides an explanation for the rephasing. Appendix B provides a detailed analysis of the capital outturn position. Members are asked to note the report and the use of the £823,000 identified revenue underspend to increase the 2018-19 MRP action. I'm happy to take any questions on the report.
Interesting also to look at page 51, which is our reserves position. You know, the minister and others. The minister and others will constantly go on about, oh, use reserve, and we will always say you can't use your reserves, which are capital, for revenue items. You can do that maybe once or twice, but there's no future. And you'll see there what the reserves are, and it's all earmarked, it says at the top. We've had this discussion before, what does earmarked mean? But it's committed reserves, reserves which are there for a purpose, and not free, except all the way down, general revenue reserve, £2 million, and that's our, you know, what the auditor would say to us, we have to keep as a uncommitted reserve, true reserve. So, if anyone says, use your reserves, there's, on page 51, the picture. Thank you,
Chair. What's the Bellman reserve for?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. This is a sort of a technical reserve. It's like the, if you remember back to the Moreland fires, where what the government might say is there's a certain element to that cost that a local authority, fire authority, must meet. So the Bellman reserve is what we set aside that if we had such an incident, that's what we would fund from our own resources, and anything above that, the government would refund in the form of a grant or financial support. So it's a technical reserve to meet the unfunded monies for those type of emergencies that the government won't meet.
Any other questions?
Yeah, just a quick question. How many years is left on the PFI reserve?
The PFI, I think, finishes in 2038 or the late 2030s. And what the PFI reserve is there's always an affordability gap when you create a PFI scheme. You often have the first few years, because not all the assets have come online, the grant is paid sort of straight away when the PFI starts, as if all the assets were in use. So what you do is you take that excess grant, if you want to call it, the first few years, to smooth out the affordability gap. So you draw down the PFI reserve, which is effectively the grant that you didn't need in the first few years, to spread out towards the end, when theoretically the costs against your regional budget for that PFI asset has the greatest gap. So it's you can interpret the PFI reserve as a smoothing reserve to smooth out the affordability gap. And it'll take us all the way to 2038, I think, when the PFI assets are handed back over. So if you didn't have that reserve, what would happen ultimately is you'd have to build in year-on-year growth to meet the affordability gap, which would increase as you got closer to the end of the PFI scheme.
Members,
note
that report?
Yeah.
Agenda item 5.
Thanks, Chair. And before I introduce this report, in my opinion, the report we just discussed gives you the real position against your budget. This is now more to do with what we have to prepare for international financial reporting standards, as if we were a private company and adhere to all private sector accounting rules and procedures. So I just wanted to say that before I start, because it's quite a technical document. Okay. So this report is the statement of accounts and the authority is required to prepare a set of financial statements in a format that's set out in the relevant accounting codes and standards. The statement of accounts attached to the report as Appendix A presents the required authority core financial statements for 2018-19, having regard to the various codes and regulations. The authority has a statutory duty to approve and sign off for publication the statement of accounts for the previous year before the 31st of July of the following year. The purpose of this report is to present the 2018-19 statement of accounts to this committee and request members approve the statements and sign it off for publication. Members would normally receive a report from the authority's auditors at Grant Thornton outlining the findings from their audit work on the financial statements and the value for money review. But as outlined in paragraphs 5 to 10, Grant Thornton feel a full property valuation must be carried out to confirm the figures in the financial statements before they can finalise the opinion. After speaking to colleagues in other fire and rescue authorities and local authorities, it would appear a number face similar challenges from their auditors, as this year auditors have sought greater assurance around figures within the financial statements, and a number of fire and rescue authorities and local authorities have stated they will not receive an auditor's opinion before the July deadline. The drive for higher levels of assurance may be linked to concerns expressed by the Financial Reporting Council that have been a decline in audit standards, and the government have been clear that they're not satisfied with the current level of audit quality. Now, probably that really refers probably to the likes of the Patisserie Valerie, Carillion, VHS Pensions, and unfortunately, when the Audit Commission was dissolved, the guidelines that our auditors received are the same as those private sector. So I think to a large degree we're being caught up with that, and secondly that the partners in these larger firms now face a great potential risk of having a sort of financial penalty if they give the right view of a company's set of accounts. So I just want to provide that background to why the auditors have felt not in a position at this point in time to issue their auditor's opinion. And that's per paragraph 11. Any amendments to the property values as a result of the valuation exercise will have no impact on the outturned position previously reported against the budget. Paragraphs 12 to paragraphs 20, pages 59 to 64, provide members with some background to the four core financial statements outlined in paragraph 13 and summarise the 2018-19 key movements and significant changes to the previous year's financial statement figures. The code and regulations require a number of notional accounting entries and adjustments that are significant in value to be included in the statements of accounts, such as depreciation and pension charges, but they are notional in nature, so they do not form part of the cost that must be funded by the authority's approved general fund budget. The table on page 60 outlines how the 2018-19 neutral general fund position previously reported in the last item is changes from a neutral position to nearly an £18 million adverse variance under the statements of the council code and regulations. Members are asked to note the draft letter of representation attached to the report as Appendix B, and this simply states that the Director of Finance and the Chair of the Committee are not aware of anything that would alter the information contained in the statements of accounts. Once Grant Thornton have completed their audit and issued an audit opinion, their audit review report, a final version of the statement of accounts, and a letter of representation will come back to members for sign off. I'm happy to take any questions on the report.
Councillor Byrom.
Thank you, Chair.
Councillor Steff.
Thank you, Chair. So, page 58, that's paragraph 5. I mean, politically, of course, we don't like the situation of being told, if you don't do X, we will have to qualify your accounts, because we've been used to having proper, unqualified accounts forever. So it is a bit of a, where does this come from? Now, I understand that it's part of the international financial regulations. But I think there arose from that a number of questions. Firstly, Is there a suggestion that we should change our valuer? If we're into a 5-year valuation cycle, which seemed to have been accepted, now we're about 3-4 years into that. We're being told, well, no, you need to tighten up on your valuation assumptions and methodology. I don't think we've probably got the choice or luxury of looking at who it is that does our revaluation, because now we're under a time is of the essence issue, not of our own making. So the first question is there any question as to the capacity of our previously contracted valuer to provide the adequate assurance that Grant Thornton are looking for?
I think the issue the auditors had wasn't so much the person who did the valuation, it was the time period. While the minimum requirement is that you must carry out a full valuation at least once every 5 years, what Grant Thornton weren't willing to accept was that, and the current value we have recommended, was his professional opinion that there was no material change, and they said between 2014-15, and now, in their opinion, too much time had happened, that without a very detailed analysis of how he had reached that opinion, they weren't willing to accept it. And despite several attempts and the value of providing information, they just basically refused to accept his view. And ultimately, the only way we could give the evidence that was requested was to carry out a full valuation. And what we've done to do that is we've gone out to tender for the work. So the current valuer, we've asked for a quote, and we've also asked for a quote from others. And we've extended it now to say that not only do we wish to carry out a full valuation of the assets as of the 31st of March 2019, but for the next 4 years, to try and avoid this going forward, can they carry out a review of at least 20% of our property every year thereafter? And as part of that exercise, provide sufficient evidence and documentation to satisfy any external auditor that there's been no material movement in the asset values, or if they believe there have, we can use that 20% sample to uplift the price. I think it's worthwhile saying that as part of all this, what does it mean? In the balance sheet, any uplift or reduction in property values is contrary out further down the balance sheet. It has no impact whatsoever in the general fund. I think what it is, it all comes back to the Finance Reporting Council, and where maybe other private sector companies have used the strength of the balance sheet to go out and borrow money off lenders and then gone into liquidation or failed within 12 months. We are not in that position. We go to the Public Works Loan Board and there's a local authority effectively. There's no question over our going concern. So we're caught up, I think, in this sort of whole, I don't want to use the word farce, but we'll use it, that we're being asked to try and adhere to the standards where the private sector have failed, significant failures in the companies. We're being asked to achieve those same standards, and in the past, we would have accepted once every 5 years and the independent valuer's professional opinion. They want more and more assurance, and the only way they're going to do that is to carry out a full valuation at 20% thereafter. And even the 20% thereafter, there's no guarantee. But my main concern was I'm using council taxpayers' money now to carry out this exercise. And we were talking about five figure sum in the first quote we've had back to carry out this 5-year review, which is potentially four times what we would have paid in the past. And I'm always trying to treat the money as if it can be owed and what value you're getting for that. But we're sort of caught now. And I have spoken to other fire authorities, local authorities, they've had the same issue. Property values, they've been challenged. Other large local authorities have their own valuers, so it's been less of an issue for them to do. Other fire and rescue authorities stand alone. They're happy to do like what we're doing. They don't have to market now, retrospectively get the information. What I haven't highlighted here, the issue we had was the decision over the public sector pensions and the cloud about the age protection. We've had to spend a few thousand pounds in getting revised past service cost figures, and we've the auditors, trying to satisfy them on that issue. I haven't had to highlight it here, but behind the scenes, it's been the most difficult audit I've had in 34 years, and that's been a consistent message across all local authorities. And it's down to this high assurance requirement. Property and pensions are the two big ones. We sorted the pension one out, but we had no choice. It wasn't a reflection on the professional ability of our independent valuer. It was the time period.
Fine, we understand it's public money and we have to maintain the highest level of scrutiny and probity about that. So if we move to a 20% 5 year, it's still back down to this 5 year thing, you see. So if we're going to have 20% 5 years, a rolling revaluation, are we still going to be asked to have a full revaluation at the end of the 5 years or earlier sort of thing?
I think the key to it will be, and that's why we've asked in the specification, that we don't simply want a 20% benchmark review and say everything's fine. What the auditors would want to see as a result of that exercise is a clear evidence that what was the result of the 20% valuation and document how they reached their conclusion. There's no guarantee we may not. I think we're probably more assured that that may not result in the same impact because in the past we've done nothing for 3 years, 4 years since last valuation. And there's the RICS figures that they quote where they can see the cost of the fire station at an index of, say, it's been 200 4 years ago, it's 250 now. And they look at those type of indices and say, we don't believe there's been a material change. What I would hope to see, if the 20% benchmark reflects on those changing indices, if the value goes up by 4, 5, 6, 70% and we uplift it, there would be less of a challenge from the auditors. I think the other problem we have is materiality. Our materiality figure is about $1.5 million. So if there's something in the financial statements that is a greater risk of uncertainty of $1.5 million or more, it's a material issue. And our property values are nearly about £65 million. So it doesn't take much of a percentage change from looking at the indices for the auditors to feel there's a risk of material change. So there is a risk of that 20%. What we're trying to really say in the way it's done, they must provide a real detailed document evidence of what the change has been based on that sample and what you can project from that. And I probably would envisage there'll be a regular uplift in property value as a result. And that would hopefully satisfy the auditors. I have a meeting with them in October. What I'll be seeking from them is that they're satisfied with that proposal. I've already told them what I'm doing, they have no objections, but I'm trying to tie them down a bit more to a sign off of that process.
Okay. Because we know that the world has changed, you know, since the crash, since the years of austerity, etc. On the other hand, Merseyside has not performed like the rest of the country. You know, we are still at a much lower basis, but the point I'm coming back to close this off now is, obviously there'll have to be a report back once we see the revaluation of those details, so that we can then sign this off. However we're going to gear that, whether it'll come to whichever meeting, a meeting of this committee or a meeting of the full authority, whatever the plan is, I'd just like to see some more, because this is probative here, this is our job, overlooking these decisions about spending money that we didn't think or expect that we were having to spend, quite a significant amount thereof. I'd like to know whether the 20% rolling revaluation is okay, and also are we going to end up again having to sort of, okay, 5 years, 3 years, you're going to have a full revaluation again. Don't have to have that now, but if we could have that in the final report.
What may assist, I understand the point, it's a valid point, is that when it's brought back, the auditors will be here. Mm-hmm. The auditors will be bringing their audit review report, so I will ensure that they cover that as part of their presentation of their report to give that satisfaction, or to the best degree they can give that point in time.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Makinson.
Thank you, Chair. Just
following on from that, if I understand incorrectly, local authorities have their own internal valuers for such things.
Some do, I know Liverpool have their own, because I spoke to Liverpool about this issue and the other authorities in the area, and they've had the same challenge, but because they have their own department, and they do carry out this 20% review, and they had a challenge, they've had an internal resource to use. So where the auditors were happy initially with their 20% valuation, they had the resource then to provide additional, I would say objective data, but a more formatted process of how they felt the valuations had changed, and they had to agree to an uplift in the valuations that we talked about. So I think size matters, unfortunately, and I think the large local authorities have architects, building control values, the small ones may not.
I just think if this is going to be a regular ongoing expense, and presumably the Transport Authority, the Waste Disposal Authority and the police are also going to have this issue, is there some value in perhaps looking through the city region to have a collective resource that could all buy into?
I was having the same thoughts as yourself, so although we, because of the agency, we went out and we asked for quotes from three private providers, and after speaking to Liverpool and them saying the resource they had, I just started a conversation with our procurement team about whether or not we could have them later on, or if it's something we can do in the future. I have a meeting with the Merseyside directors of finance in a couple of weeks. I'll raise it with them. What we often found, though, we had this with the same treasury management, you know, we buy in our service of Liverpool, all the local authorities have their own, so I said, well, why don't we just have one group, you know, and have a more collection of that specialist resource. Obviously, I can't criticise your profession, but directors of finance tend to like their own resource and use them. So I can ask, I can't force. I can raise it as an issue, but I was intending to try and talk to procurement, because we had to do this as a matter of agency, to say, is it worth us asking for the local authorities who do in the area who have their own values, but for a quote, we could obviously go to Liverpool, but then those would say, why don't we go to us? So I want to have that conversation with them. We've not committed to anything at this point. We could just do the one-off full valuation and then say, how do we do this in the future? And that might then give